So good afternoon, everybody. You're very welcome to our Link and Learn session today. My name is Laura Wadding. I'm a director in the Risk Advisory function in Ireland. The focus of our webinar today is going to be on the impact of Brexit on asset management. And we've got a number of great speakers this afternoon. Our agenda is set out here. We're going to take a look at the political and economic developments around Brexit and works in our economics division in London is going to speak to that. Then we'll take a look at the impact on the asset management industry from a UK perspective. We've got Joy, Kershaw and Katherine in our UK division, and they're going to take a look at substance, delegation, passporting, considerations for implementation. And then we're going to go global. So we'll look at how the regulators and firms are responding to Brexit, both from a UK perspective and from an Irish perspective. And my colleague Sandrine, Leclercq in Luxembourg is going to talk to the Luxembourg view as well. So with that then, we'll kick off. So I'll invite Alex to start his section. Thanks.
Thanks, Laura. Good afternoon. I'm Alex Cole from the economics team here in London. And as Laura said, I guess I'm just going to set the scene in terms of the economic and political context or background to Brexit. The first slide here just highlights that, so this first slide, this first table has real GDP growth rates for Northwest Europe countries. It has growth rates, the average growth rates for the 7 years up to 2016, and then the forecast growth rates for 2017, this year, and 2019. And I guess the key takeaway from this is that for most countries across Europe, we're in the midst of a fairly strong economic recovery, and the growth rates that we're seeing now and are forecast to see next year are fairly robust and stronger than the growth rates that we've seen in recent years. There's a few exceptions to that, but generally it's a case of a fairly strong recovery at the moment across Europe, and actually that's also mirrored outside Europe, in the global economy. For most parts of the global economy at the moment, the economy is looking fairly strong, and at least as strong as we've seen in the last 7 years or so. The next slide. So, stronger growth rates in terms of GDP growth rates across most of Europe and the global economy as well. That's mirrored in survey data that we're seeing as well. So this chart here just shows business confidence across Northwest Europe markets. This is an average of business confidence. So surveys asking businesses in these markets how confident they are about the financial prospects for their businesses in the next year. And you see that, again, across most of Northwest Europe, it's a fairly positive story, and business confidence is actually as high as we've seen since before the financial crisis in 2008-09. So again, a positive story in terms of growth rates, reflected also in terms of what businesses are saying about the operating environment for them. As you might have seen in the first table, that there are some exceptions to that, and probably the most notable of those is the UK. So a fairly positive story for Europe and the global economy at the moment. However, the UK economy is certainly doesn't seem to be benefiting from the growth that we're seeing elsewhere, and actually the UK economy from the hard data and the survey data seems to be slowing at the moment, and actually forecast growth rates this year of around 1.5% would represent probably the slowest growth we've seen since around 2012-13 at the time of the previous Euro crisis. So generally a positive story in most European markets. However, there are some outliers, and the UK does appear to be one of those. Lots of factors behind why the UK is seeing slower growth at the moment. However, it's clear that uncertainties around Brexit, and this shows in numerous surveys, certainly isn't helping the economy at the moment. So this final slide that I'm going to talk to actually is just a slide which talks to the political process of Brexit at the moment. There's a lot on here that I'm not going to go into in detail. Obviously, at the bottom there, there's a timeline which shows kind of where we've come from in the last 6 months in terms of the process of Brexit and where we are or where we intend to go with the rest of the process. So the UK has handed in its notice triggered Article 50. It is to leave the European Union on the 29th of March next year. However, the UK and the EU are still in the process of negotiating the terms of that withdrawal. So before the UK exits the European Union, there is a process of negotiating under which terms it leaves. Certain issues still to be settled are the financial settlement, so what the UK owes the European Union, citizens' rights, the border between the Republic of Ireland and Northern Ireland, and what transition period, if any, there will be when the UK leaves before a free trade agreement is negotiated. The current negotiating timelines are, by this autumn coming, it is intended that there will be an agreement over the legal terms of that exit. That will be voted on by the UK Parliament, and then the EU will also ratify it by February of next year, ahead of that planned exit on the 29th of March 2019. However, at this stage, as I said, there are a number of things that still haven't been legally agreed upon, there is no legal certainty at this point that there will be a transition period, and we won't have legal certainty on that until February of next year. In terms of the issues that the two parties are still trying to get agreement on, perhaps the Irish border and the wider question of what customs relationships will be in place between the UK and the EU are probably the most intractable at the moment. In terms of the Irish border, the EU requires that there should be no physical border infrastructure between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland. However, it's not clear how to resolve that problem and under which time frame we'll be able to do that in. If there isn't a solution, the withdrawal agreement and the provisionally agreed transition agreement may fail. So that's it, I guess, about kind of briefly about the economic context and where we are in terms of the political process of Brexit. I'm now going to hand over to Joy, who's going to talk about the impact of Brexit on the asset management industry.
Hello, so my name is Joy Kershaw, and I'm going to talk about the impact of Brexit on the asset management industry. As we know, the asset management industry is international in nature, so it's common for asset management groups to have portfolio managers based in one jurisdiction, funds domiciled in another jurisdiction, and clients located across multiple jurisdictions. So how will Brexit affect this international model? Well, one important point to note is that firms regulated under UCITS, AIFMD and MIFID can only delegate or outsource portfolio management to firms in non-EU countries if supervisory cooperation arrangements are in place between regulators. European regulators have not yet signed such agreements with the FCA. They are expected to do so, but this cannot be completely guaranteed, so firms should take this into account in their Brexit planning. Another important thing to consider is the supervisory expectations on how much substance an EU entity needs to have when certain functions are delegated or outsourced. In 2017, ESMA published a number of opinions on supervisory convergence in the context of Brexit. These included a set of general principles as well as opinions specific to investment management and investment firms. In those opinions, ESMA set out its expectations on outsourcing and delegation, including how much substance needs to be present in the EU when certain functions are performed outside the EU. For example, key functions that must be present in the EU include internal control functions, IT control infrastructure, risk assessment, compliance functions, and key management functions. board members and senior managers in the EU need to have effective decision-making powers. And the key executives and senior managers are expected to be employed in the entity's member state and work there proportionately to their role. Also, EU entities should have adequate levels of own funds and liquidity. So firms will need to take all this into account when assessing their post-Brexit operating models. So looking in more detail at what ESMA said on the delegation of portfolio management, ESMA said that EU entities need to evidence objective reasons for delegation. And ESMA said that delegating portfolio management to non-EU entities could make the oversight and supervision of the delegated functions more difficult. So national regulators should give special consideration to such delegation arrangements and be satisfied that their implementation is justified based on objective reasons, despite the additional risks which may arise from them. ESMA also said that UCITS investors should benefit from the same level of protection as AIF investors, even though the UCITS delegation rules are not as detailed as those in the AIFMD. ESMA said that asset managers should not delegate investment management functions to an extent that exceeds by a substantial margin the investment management functions performed internally. And this assessment must be carried out at the level of each individual fund. So asset managers must perform investment management functions for each fund they manage and cannot delegate portfolio management and risk management functions for a particular fund in their entirety, even when they perform such functions for other funds. The European Commission has also published a draft proposal on the review of the European supervisory authorities. This included a proposal to give ESMA new powers to vet delegation arrangements, and this is currently being negotiated in the Council of the EU and the European Parliament. So how will all this affect the industry? Well, ESMA's opinion is not legally binding, but we do expect national regulators to take it into account, and there have already been moves by the Irish and Luxembourg regulators to strengthen their local requirements on delegation and substance. Nevertheless, delegation is a well-established global norm, and ESMA acknowledges that an efficient operating model may involve delegation. So firms should be able to continue to delegate portfolio management, provided that they meet regulatory expectations. And firms will need to familiarize themselves with the local requirements in the jurisdictions in which they operate. And we'll talk more about the local requirements in Ireland and Luxembourg later in this webinar. So moving on to passporting, as we all know, some firms currently rely on EU passports to access clients across the EU. And when the UK leaves the EU, it is expected that firms will lose the right to passport services between the UK and the EU. Some firms need to consider their operating models to ensure that they will still be able to access their clients. And there are various potential target operating models which may be suitable for different types of firms depending on their business. For example, this slide shows one model which involves an EU fund, which could be either a UCITS or an AIF, and an EU management company, which then delegates portfolio management to a UK entity. This will allow firms to benefit from the EU-wide passports available under UCITS or AIFMD to manage EU funds if the management company and fund are in different member states, and to market these funds across the EU. These funds could be distributed to clients across the EU by an EU distributor with a MiFID passport or by an EU management company. The UK distributor could be used to reach UK clients, or in some cases, an EU distributor could be used to reach non-retail investors in the UK. The next slide shows the case of a non-EU fund, which would be an AIF, because UCITS funds must be domiciled in the EU. Assuming that the third country passport, which is envisaged under the AIFMD, is not extended to the UK, this firm and fund would not benefit from any EU passports. And this would also be the case if the fund were an EU fund with a UK management company. The UK firm could access some EU non-retail clients via national private placement regimes. However, in some EU member states, the national private placement regime is very restrictive or does not allow marketing at all, so firms will need to ensure they comply with local requirements. the UK-based management company could delegate portfolio or risk management to another entity inside or outside the EU. And the distribution could be carried out by the UK management company or by an EU distributor. So looking at the position outside fund structures, the next slide shows a UK portfolio manager managing segregated mandates for EU investors via an EU branch or subsidiary. If it was via a branch, that branch would not have an EU passport, so the firm would need a branch in every member state where it has clients. If there is an EU subsidiary, this entity would have a passport, so would be able to access clients across the EU. It would be possible for the EU subsidiary to outsource portfolio management back to the UK, assuming that supervisory cooperation arrangements are in place. However, the EU entity would have responsibility for the UK entity's activities and would therefore need enough substance to oversee these activities effectively. Alternatively, MiFID II does allow third country firms to provide services to EU clients if this is at the client's own initiative. So no marketing has been carried out by the UK portfolio manager or by anyone acting on their behalf. Firms also need to consider how they will treat existing mandates, and we are seeing firms taking different approaches here. Some intend to transfer mandates to EU companies, while others will retain them. While firms can continue to manage existing mandates, they need to consider how they will deal with any mandate changes, such as future inflows or amendments to the investment strategy. So I'm now going to talk about equivalence and third country passporting. MiFID II provides for the possibility of third countries to be granted equivalence, and AIFMD allows for the possibility of a non-EU passport being granted to third countries. However, to date, no third country has been granted such access under either directive. Under AIFMD, ESMA has submitted positive advice to the European Commission on the extension of the passport to 12 non-EU countries. However, it remains to be seen whether the passport will be granted to these countries. It seems reasonable to expect the UK to be deemed equivalent, as it has implemented all EU directives and is in the process of incorporating directly applicable EU regulation into UK law. However, the decision to grant equivalence or a non-EU passport has a political element and the timeframes are unclear. So firms should not place undue reliance on the UK being granted access in a short timeframe. In addition, once equivalence is granted, it can be withdrawn by the EU at a later date, for example, if regulatory standards were to diverge. I'm now going to hand over to my colleague, Katherine Davidge, who will talk about the practical considerations for implementation.
Thank you, Joy. Over the next couple of slides, I want to highlight some of the areas that firms need to think about in their implementation plans. One of the key things that I'd like to get across is that this isn't just a regulatory and tax issue, although those are the two main areas of focus that firms often have and form a lot of our initial discussions with clients. In terms of the regulatory side of things, this is often one of the key drivers with the target operating model design. So depending on what activities and services you're providing and where will help establish what regulatory permissions you need and what directives you'll be operating under. So whether that's AIFMD, UCITS, MiFID II, or in fact all three. From that, there's also a lead into which location you might choose. And there are some slight differences between locations. Occasionally, there are differences on capital requirements, often due to the implementation of CRD4 and whether countries have made use of opt-outs for CRD3 firms. And there are some differences as well on remuneration requirements, which is obviously often a key issue for staff. Once firms have got their business model decided, selected a location and have their legal structure set up, they're then ready to start looking at other aspects of the implementation. If you're going to be looking at relocating, whether that's building out significantly an existing entity or starting from scratch, then you're going to have to actually think about the practicalities of moving to a new place. So that will include things like your physical location, your infrastructure around that, how many staff you'll need, whether that's transferring existing staff or accessing local talent, And things like IT requirements, how the entity will feed into the business continuity planning. So a lot of sort of practical requirements that you need to consider. There's also outsourcing arrangements. So where you're outsourcing to third parties, you need to start understanding how Brexit's going to impact them. Will they in fact be moving some of the services they're providing to you into EU locations to enable you to outsource within the EU? And are you looking at outsourcing functions from your new EU entity back to the UK at all? The whole outsourcing piece obviously has to be looked at in the context of the substance requirements that Joy's already mentioned and that Laura and Sandrine will talk about further. In terms of the tax side of things, it's quite important to make sure that this is considered at the early stages of planning. If activities and businesses and revenues are moving outside of the UK, there may be tax implications to that. And reworking your operating structure and services may also have different tax implications. I know that our tax team are working with clients on a number of different issues, covering both direct and indirect tax matters, valuations of assets, and estimating exit charges for clients. On the HR side of things, firms really need to be starting to identify those staff that will be moving to their new location and determining whether that's in-house moves or looking at local hires. Given the popularity of a few key jurisdictions, then obviously markets in those areas will start to become more difficult to hire within and salaries, et cetera, start to get pushed up. We've also found that for some firms where they're hoping one or two key individuals might move and they're relatively open and flexible, or the firm is relatively open and flexible on location, then actually location preference of those key individuals is often taken into account. And from an HR perspective, there's also a feed into personal taxation issues and remuneration requirements on the regulatory side that will be a factor for people moving. And finally, on the repapering side of things, I think it's important that whilst you might be the recipient of an awful lot of repapering from your brokers, you also have to make sure you've worked through what exercises you need to do, what contracts you might need to repaper or novate, and the impact of changes with your brokers and other providers might have on your contracts. I think it's very important to make sure that you have a good understanding of any timeframes required. If you're going to have to reissue a prospectus or get an investor agreement to anything, you need to make sure you factored in all of those timescales to your work stream. And for those of you that will be relying heavily on external legal resource for this, you also need to make sure you're booking that time in as well. As with all of these things, if everything's left at the last minute, you risk a rush of trying to get things done and actually not having the specialist resources available to assist you. Okay, I'm now going to look a little bit more on the UK perspective of Brexit. In terms of the UK regulatory authorities, the FCA and the UK government, specifically the Treasury, have been working closely together, looking at how the EU legislation can be incorporated into UK legislation to make things as seamless as possible and provide continuity to firms operating in the UK. The UK has been quite open about the fact that it would like to continue having open markets. The FCA does not envisage putting up further barriers to EU firms wanting to access UK investors. And they feel that there are significant benefits to both the EU and the UK in having open markets and continuing aspects of the global industry that we currently have. Finally, for those EU firms that operate within the UK, either through cross-border services arrangements or via branches, and the same for funds that passport into the UK, the Treasury and the FCA have announced that there will be a temporary permissions regime. that will facilitate the continuation of this arrangement should the transitional agreement, the transitional period not be agreed. And this means that those firms will continue to have exactly the same ability to access the UK markets. And for those that are based here as branches, we expect FCA will, in time, announce how it anticipates directly authorising those branches. Finally, in terms of the Brexit work that we're seeing clients undertake, this is generally falling into three key streams: the diagnostic and contingency planning stage, the preparation of your new entity and structure stage, and then finally implementation. Generally speaking, we are still seeing some firms in this first diagnostic and contingency planning stage. So if some of you haven't yet started your Brexit projects, or really got going, then it's not too late, but I would urge you to start things quite quickly. In terms of the preparation stage, firms are looking at submitting regulatory applications, identifying key senior staff, and working towards getting things up and running, but not actually taking actions that would be difficult to be undone. Very few firms from the asset management are actually at the implementation stage. We are aware of some asset managers that have increased permissions or have new subsidiaries authorised in various locations, but actual physically relocating staff and services and transferring agreements isn't actually happening just yet. In terms of sort of different approaches, the larger firms tend to set up working groups and focus and treat Brexit as a very large project, and that tends to be something that they need to do. We find smaller firms are often able to make decisions more quickly and try to work in a way that's a little bit more flexible, and that is often feasible for them due to the size and nature of their business. I'm now going to hand on to Laura, who's going to talk through some of the Irish requirements.
Thanks very much, Katherine. So what I'd like to do is just take a look at this through the lens of Ireland and a very established fund management sector and industry that we have in this country. So, I mean, Ireland is the domicile for 5% of worldwide investment fund assets, third largest global centre and the second largest in Europe. So it's a very well established sector and predominantly around the management of funds, so UCITS management companies and AIFMs. And also asset servicing, there's a huge asset servicing sector here too. So depositories and fund administrators of Irish domicile funds are based in Ireland as well. So it's a pretty well established sector. And on the face of it, you know, there's a well-established governance framework around that as well, so around the management of collective investment schemes. And the regulator here has developed its own thoughts on the role of the management company, and it has developed guidance for management companies, for the boards of management companies, and the effective oversight of its delegates, and in the context of risk management and distribution and the role of the board and all of that. So, and that would be well known as consultation paper 86, CP 86, and that's now effective in Ireland since earlier this month for all management companies. So that's well established. But what we're seeing in the market now as a result of Brexit and in advance of Brexit is that those management companies, many of them are looking to extend their licences to be able to provide ancillary MiFID services, where they wouldn't be able to do that today. So that might be in the context of portfolio management or fund distribution. And this is where some of the challenges start to arise. So the regulator is very comfortable with the management company that exists here. They're very comfortable with the structure of the board, and they're very comfortable that they've got access to those entities, and they consider them to be supervisable, if that's the word. But now, as those entities are looking to extend their licences to be able to perform what the regulator might see as more risky services, the application process is actually quite a lengthy one. And this has even been reiterated in the last couple of days by the Central Bank, to see that an application almost equivalent to establishing a new MIFID entity in Ireland. So there is a fair amount of work that needs to go into that. And second to that, in the market, we see investment firms. So MIFID entities authorised in the UK and branched into Ireland are having to replace their branch with a subsidiary entity, which is authorised here and regulated both from a conduct perspective and a prudential perspective. And this increases the risk for the regulator as well. So they would regulate and supervise branches of EU entities here from a conduct perspective, but they wouldn't have that prudential responsibility. But they will when those entities are subsidiaries. So that again just creates a heightened awareness of risk in the regulator's mind and forces firms to be very, very articulate in what they actually submit to the regulator as part of their application. So some of the areas of focus that we've seen through our work with our clients in the application process for, in particular, when applying for a MIFID activity license or restructuring an existing MIFID entity. It's really important to be able to clearly articulate in a simplified and transparent manner all of the following facts. So the governance and organisation, so the what functions are local, what functions are will be part of a group of companies that will be relied upon locally, where's the independence in those, what is the independence between the risk function and the finance function, and again within senior executive individuals. So it's really important to be able to get the articulation of that correct, and also who reports to who, and what's the direct reporting line to the Irish board, which is very important for the regulator. Culture. So culture is a theme that's coming up in pretty much every sector at the moment, not just in banking or insurance, but in asset management as well. And Central Bank wants to be able to see through the application process how firms promote good behaviour, so good regulatory behaviour. Where are the interests of investors being protected and how? And how, how are employees incentivized to maintain that good behaviour? How are they disincentivized, for bad behaviour? So these are some of the questions that the regulator are asking. Risk management and internal controls. So I think Joy touched on this earlier as well. Like, this is absolutely key. And it's a key element of the substance question. It's a key part of the risk management process that's applied by the central bank when they're considering applications. So what is the risk? Where is it managed? How is it managed? And how will it be managed going forward? And I'll come on to that in a second as well. So outsourcing and business continuity. Which are very closely linked, actually. And there's a few things happening around this. So some of you may have seen that the European Banking Authority has just issued a consultation paper on draft guidelines for outsourcing arrangements, and they will effectively replace the guidance that has been out there since 2006. And that guidance will cover banks and investment firms. And the regulator here is also very active in when it comes to outsourcing, and they're doing a lot of work across sectors, across banking, insurance, and funds, to align their thoughts on what a good outsourcing framework would look like. And they will come out with a framework at some point, which will articulate what they expect. And that's something that we need to consider. And linked to that, then they've looked at business continuity, and it's often looked at as part of outsourcing arrangements as well. So if the actual work is being done elsewhere, how does that tie into the business continuity plan? And how can you ensure that if there's an issue in that other location, that the work can continue? So how do you build that in, and what's your exit plan? So worst case scenario, if you can't retrieve the work that is normally done by another party, how do you exit that relationship and start a new one? So this is really very much on the focus of the regulator at the moment, and a huge part then, so we can see that they're asking those questions of existing financial institutions in Ireland, and then they're transferring that line of questioning to the application process for new entities as well. So they really are aligning their views on all of this. The business model is absolutely key to the whole thing. And again, like, it kind of talks to what the central bank has said recently in terms of, you know, don't stick an application into the regulator if just to get one in there. If, you know, if you're not sure what your business model is going to be, if you're not sure what your business will look like, if you haven't thought about this as a strategy, then you need to think about that and be able to really well articulate the business model, the business plan, both from a day one and a day two perspective. So having an entity authorised in Ireland is one thing, but what do you do with that entity in the longer term? And again, maybe to talk to some of the prudential side of things, this is a really important part of the application process. So it's not just the form filling, it's not just the nice graphics that demonstrate the org structure of the organisation, but they want to see the meat in the policies, procedures and documentation, the recovery plans, the client asset management plan, you know, market abuse policy, the capital adequacy reports and plans. This is what the regulator expects as part of the application process. It is very detailed. They do go through it with a fine-tooth comb. They do generally come back with a list of X number of questions. We've kind of set a benchmark. So if you get between 30 and 40 questions, that's really, really good. If you get somewhere over 100, that's probably not too good. And worst case scenario, the application is rejected outright because it's just too incomplete. It is something to consider, and there's a lot of detail that goes in there. And so just maybe moving on to the next slide. And Joy has spoken to this already in relation to the ESMA, or the European Commission's Notice of Stakeholders on asset management. So I'm not going to go into too much detail here, but maybe just to highlight a couple of the left-wing challenges that might present themselves as part of this whole thing. The passporting piece, I think, is not to be underestimated. The Irish funds sector services, Irish domiciled funds predominantly, whether they're ACE or UCITS, but those funds tend not to distribute in Ireland, you know, on a wide level. Some funds do, but predominantly those funds distribute elsewhere, and an awful lot of them distribute into the UK. So this passporting piece is going to be really key. And then linked then to the cooperation agreement between Ireland and the UK. So there's no doubt that that is going to be really important to the industry here, given that whilst the fund might be domiciled here, the assets, the owner of the assets in the fund, the beneficial owner of the assets, an awful lot of those are UK investors. So I think that's really important. The other part is maybe the staff and transfer of resources, and I think Katherine touched on it as well. So having to have substance here in the area of portfolio management, for example, may not always be the easiest thing to do, given that that's not really how the resource market has evolved over the years. So we've got a lot of asset servicers, we've got a lot of people who are skilled in oversight, in relationship management, and some of the tech side of things, and the industry is evolving as well in line with market demands, but wouldn't probably have huge resources on the portfolio management side. So it is a key consideration for firms extending their license or setting up a new entity here. And then maybe just to mention something like GDPR, so, you know, one of these far-reaching regulatory requirements, you know, the nature of asset management is such that data is collected by, you know, predominantly maybe by one or two entities, but then transferred between parties to a fund, used for different purposes, maybe transferred outside the EU today, to an outsourced provider of the administrator, for example, and so that's something else that needs to be considered under GDPR. So if things need to change because the data is now going to be outsourced, is now going to be processed in the UK on behalf of an Irish entity, it may be necessary to revisit contracts and also to maybe potentially perform privacy impact assessments. So I think these are the things that are going to have a knock-on impact as well as the regulatory side of things. And then just maybe to take a quick look at the timeline for having an authorisation approved by the central bank. not to be underestimated in any way, shape or form is the key facts document, so the KFD, when applying to establish a new entity here, is absolutely key, which is probably why it's called the key facts document, but it's more than just the key facts. It is the basically the precursor to the complete application. It should have as much information in it as is possible to include at the point in time. The challenge with the key facts document is that the statutory clock to have an entity approved doesn't start until the key facts document is approved by the central bank. So whilst there, you know, we sort of have an experience where we've seen these timelines play out, it could take longer, could take less time. But until the actual clock starts within which the regulator is required to approve an application or revert with comments, then you're kind of at the mercy of you know, how many questions come out following the initial submission of the KFD. What's the capacity like in the authorization team in the central bank? What's your own capacity like? And we've seen this with some of our clients whereby they just don't have the people to put the time and energy and effort into creating these, you know, future-looking policies, procedures, and all of the details that need to go into the application. And most of that work needs to be done during the preparation of the key facts document, to be honest. So it can take a bit of a while. Once the application goes in, then you're into the statutory, the clock. And the regulator has come out very recently and warned firms that they are running out of time. So there's only a matter of weeks left if firms want to have licenses extended or new firms authorised by the time that Brexit is effective. So there's really not much time left to think about these things. And so I think that was kind of some of the key messages and experiences that we've seen from a local regulatory perspective. I'm going to hand over to my colleague Sandrine in Luxembourg, who's going to give a view from Luxembourg perspective. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Laura, and good afternoon, everyone. Yeah, so Luxembourg view, what I propose here, not to go again through this technical dimensions, which were, I think, presented at length very interestingly by my colleagues, but rather to look at the situation in Luxembourg in the sense that what are the practical approach taken by the regulators and also what we observe from the different players who are impacted by Brexit. So just to start with and justify that Luxembourg is included in the panel, obviously it's just because Luxembourg is well known and well placed worldwide and European wide as a fun place. It was known and still known as a powerful place for UCITS distribution and domiciliation. Since 10 years, it has become very famous and used as a place to build alternative investment funds, and in particular over the 5 years, private equity funds, real estate funds, and debt funds. So that is just to illustrate that obviously Luxembourg is very much concerned, if not directly impacted or negatively impacted by the Brexit. Go ahead. Next slide, thank you. Yeah, so maybe a perspective on the Luxembourg regulator. I think that I would not repeat what Laura said. I think that at European level, it's not to be so clear what European regulator wants to achieve, in particular through the ESMA advice. I think that what is important to note is that CSSF is willing and has always been willing to be first in class to show that they are really willing to play along the lines. So here, summarizing three initiatives of the CSSF recently. So 2 years ago, when the Brexit was announced as a possibility, CSSF went to visit proactively some large asset managers in the UK just to reassure them that they would be ready to welcome them if they fit with the profile of the marketplace, because obviously Luxembourg is quite small and could not host everyone. Second thing, CSSF has willingly anticipated, not systematically, but as a test experience involving ESMA and European regulators in the review of certain application files since 2 months. This shows how much they would like to be able to build their doctrine and their practice in a way that is fully consistent with the ESMA approach, or even be proactive in the debate and making sure that ESMA will come back with recommendations that will fully meet the practical goal and the expectation of the industry. CSSF parallelly also launched an initiative internally to draft a text, circular, more precisely. Circular are not laws, they are not binding, but they are supposed to reflect market practice and CSSF expectations, so it de facto it's binding. And what does this circular, which will be released during the summer, it codifies more or less every principle of concern, major principle that are contained in the ESMA advice of June 17, which was mentioned earlier by my colleague. Next slide, please. Thank you. So, what do we observe in terms of behavior of the actors, UK players in particular, which are impacted? I think it's important to make a distinction between the UCITS asset manager and the other ones, alternative investment fund managers. As far as the UCITS are concerned, I think they have been the first mover for a reason which are not legal or regulatory, but more to answer the early reaction of investors starting to exit from these funds, because they are open-ended, massively just because of threats. So they had no choice but to consider the possible relocation of their fund structure in on the continent, or to think about a way to retain access to the market on both sides of the border. So potentially what we have seen is the creation of parallel funds, or the creation of master feeder funds, even though there is great uncertainty about master feeder funds in the UCIT context, because as you know, master feeder, according to UCIT regulation, can only be EU fund investing in another EU fund. Now these players more or less have achieved and implemented the strategy. What they are now focusing on, as Laura mentioned, is the practicalities of the Brexit when we will come to reality. Very detailed elements such as how currency hedging will be addressed, the eligibility of a master fund, for example, or is the agreements, as you know, UK standard agreements containing a lot of reference to EU law, raise a lot of issues and attentions also with regard to the situation and the legal risk potentially raised by or involved in continuing using this type of agreement in the future for EU players. Now looking at the alternative investment fund managers, I think those ones are now swiftly building the strategy. Some of them have already initiated the implementation of the strategy, i.e. to be clear, redomiciling on the continent or in Ireland. We see a lot of them obviously in Luxembourg coming and consulting us. We distinguish two categories of players among these alternative investment fund managers. The one who already have a group presence, another entity of the same group present in Luxembourg. For those ones, what we saw 1 year ago is that they were more considering or trying to assess feasibility of redomiciling their activities within the existing entity. The experience proved that it was not necessarily the choice that these players made at the end of the day. Some of them decided to create separate entities or to turn to a white label solution. The main reason of this is that for these asset managers belonging to group, banking group, for instance, the strategy priorities is not always the same, and there were some conflicts in terms of client targets and products, etc. So the solution retained were not necessarily the most obvious ones. As for the other one with no presence in Luxembourg and willing to go to Luxembourg, they had basically two choices. The first one, obviously, is to create your own entity or entities, Manco and MIFID entities, or to go for the so-called white labeling management companies which offer you just to rent their services, and I think the model is well known both in Luxembourg and Ireland. But in both cases, for these two categories of players, I think that the idea is definitely to, as much as possible, retain the portfolio management activities and teams in the UK. So the only sharp concern that they see is how do they organize their client-facing activities, especially when these houses have a people lodge with them directly within the organization, crossing the borders to talk to the clients, or for those also parallelly running discretionary portfolio management activities. Those entities have sales teams who need to cross the border to talk to clients, and this obviously will not be possible in principle post-Brexit. Now, the issue here is that client-facing activities is basically what you cannot sub-delegate by construction, just because this is part of your genotype. So we have seen on the market a lot of white-label management companies or other providers thinking on options, solutions, all their fantasies, I have to say, in most cases, to be able to support these client-facing activities. But obviously, the most efficient way, even if there is strong resistance still, is to relocate the sales team directly. The only ones who don't have the problems, and among the large players, many of them have used this operating model, they have already branches established in the EU, in different EU member states, where they have lodged their sales team to talk to the local markets. Those ones, of course, will be able to retain their teams where they are for the moment. What they will need to do, of course, is to transfer those branches under the roof of an EU entity, so that the passport can apply and be the basis for the establishment of that branch. Of course, there are some possibilities also regarding certain host countries to keep the branch under the UK roof, but this will be subject to certain conditions, unilateral agreement and recognition, so not really safe. And what we see at this stage is for these firms, impacted to, they'd like to have a consistent and unique and single strategy addressing their concerns. So basically, they transfer all the branches to Luxembourg under the roof of their Luxembourg entity. Another element which is important is cost, of course, especially for those players, and it's the majority who want to keep the operation in the UK. So the fee and the concern is to have to duplicate everything. There is this possibility for management company under EU laws to expand the license as a management company to MiFID type of activities. So what they do in 80% of the cases is that if they have their proprietary management company, they apply for the extension of the license and they lodge all their activities under this single roof. Next slide, please. Thank you. Other categories of actors which are heavily impacted as well, and we do not necessarily think about them in the first place, is non-EU players, and typically the US players or Asian players who have who are used to choose and locate their European operation in the UK. Those ones are obviously indirectly and directly impacted. For some of them, for which the European market is of importance as compared to the global strategy worldwide, they will be looking at the same solution as the one I was mentioning for the UK players. But for some others, we notice that they are more questioning the opportunity to continue developing business in Europe. What we see is that they are very concerned about the cost of all this, previously already with the IFM regulation, but now even more with this Brexit, which will oblige them to duplicate to some extent their operations if they are also, and that's generally the case, interested in other parts, in marketing or developing in other parts of the world, in other parts of Europe. But amongst these actors, especially the alternative in the alternative and real asset management world, they have another challenge, which is converging or bringing a momentum to take decisions regarding their future presence in Europe. basically they are faced with a dilemma. They have generally several holdings, if not 100 holdings sometimes, based in Luxembourg, holding companies, SPV companies, I should say, which are used for the purpose of investing in their targeted assets. As a result of the BEPS tax reform, those actors are will be bound to demonstrate substance for this holding company. And a way to demonstrate substance, of course, is to lodge other regulated activities or other economic activities. So, for instance, we have seen some Chinese actors considering potentially to keep their SPVs in Luxembourg and to buy a trust company to support the activity of these SPVs, and also to take the opportunity to address the demand of one big, large, single investor interested in them launching a fund in Europe. So I think their approach is more opportunistic for those ones. Last but not least, for those players, even more than the UK players, they are very concerned about the fact that they could continue to use the platform of the group, being it in terms of expert teams or being in terms of IT platforms, because those large groups generally have these functions centralized, supporting the all the entities of the group. I think in spite of the ESMA advice and the focus and concern about delegation setup, especially when delegation occurs with a third country, there are many ways to address this, and there are still some space, or a lot of space, I should say, to use the resources of a group outside the territory, especially if we are talking about technical means. I think if players delegate, that's problematic because you have a shift of liability which is pushed outside the European territory, which is highly regulated. But if you go for outsourcing is another way to leverage on resources without shifting responsibility below or outside, and that works very well with our recent experience with CSSF, having consulted ESMA in this respect, which allows this these players to continue leverage on the group. Otherwise, probably, most probably, these players will consider just withdrawing for the from the European Union, withdrawing from the investment management market, but also withdrawing their SPVs. Well, just to terminate on my end, with respect to Luxembourg, this slide just in an illustration of the different options that players willing to relocate in Luxembourg may consider. So on the right hand of the slide, you can see the rent a Manco solution, which I mentioned earlier. So the Manco is existing and is dedicated to servicing clients. So you just enter into an agreement with this service provider, and the service provider may then further delegate the portfolio management to your UK teams. The solution in the middle, or the solution on the left-hand side of the slide, I should say, is for these players to consider having one entity for each of their activities, UCITS, Manco, IFM, and one MIFID entity for their DPM activities or investment advice activities. In practice, it doesn't happen, it never happens. There is strong preference at this stage for commingling and bundling all these activities under the same roof, which is the scenario represented in the middle of the slide. So leveraging on, mutualized resources to perform activities, which even though not subject to the exact same rules, have a lot of converging factors. So that's all for my part.
Thank you. Thank you, Sandrine. I'm just conscious that we're nearly at 5 o'clock, so we're going to skip the Q&A. We've had a couple of questions through from listeners, which is great, so thank you very much, and we will respond to those individuals directly. You can see there our contact details, so if anybody does have questions for us individually or collectively, please don't hesitate to drop us an email. This presentation and the recording of the webinar will be available for the next 24 hours if you click into the link on your invitation. If you can't download a copy of the slides and you'd like to get a copy, then please don't hesitate to get in touch with any one of us there on the contact page. So take a note of our email address if you don't have them. So there's not a whole lot left to say. We hope you enjoyed the webinar, and we hope we'll have the occasion to reconnect. Our next Link and Learn is scheduled for Thursday, the 13th of September, on the topic of regulated private equity real estate funds. Okay, thank you very much. Good afternoon.